The politics of it have played to the point that we just saw in the president. And we're going to hear about this during the midterms. You know, it'll be football season, of course, as we're coming up to the election day in November. We're going to hear about this and see its effects every Sunday. This rule was not done in consultation with the players. Was that intentional? Was that wrong?
Well, I think it was quite intentional, and I think you see the reaction from the NFL Players Association that they're quite upset about that, and rightly so. I think without having any buy-in from the player side was misguided, and I think they should go back and look at it, and it should have been something that was done with both sides considered.
The Jets, Chris Johnson, Woody Johnson's brother. Woody Johnson obviously working for the administration right now as the ambassador to Britain. His brother's running the team and says, I will cover all fines in this regard. Do you think every team should do that?
Well, I think that would be a great gesture, and I think it would be something that would be appropriate, even though the ruling that came down was supposed to be unanimous by all 32 teams. We know that initially there was some dissent among owners, so I don't think that all of them have been on board, and I guess given Johnson's current status, that shows that a lot of people did not agree with that unanimous consent. So I support that wholeheartedly.
George Martin, always a pleasure. Thank you for the perspective.
Chris, good run on New Day, and very best to you in the future.
Appreciate it, big brother. Thank you very much. All right, thanks to our international viewers for watching. For you, CNN Talk is next. For our U.S. viewers, there is a lot of news on this Thursday morning. Let's get after it. Good morning. Welcome to your New Day. In just hours, a bipartisan group of top congressional leaders will get briefed on the FBI's investigation into Russia meddling, including the FBI's use of a confidential source to determine if Russia was colluding with the Trump campaign. Now, this briefing comes only after Democrats complained that the White House was politicizing intelligence by initially only going to have a briefing with Republicans. Meantime, the president continues to repeat his unproven claim that the Obama administration planted a spy in his campaign.
And there's breaking news from North Korea. Reporters, including CNN's Will Ripley, just witnessed the regime blowing up tunnels reportedly used for their nuclear testing. Now, this comes as the war of words between the U.S. and North Korea is escalating. A North Korean official says it is ready for a nuclear showdown if talks with the U.S. fail. So let's begin our coverage with CNN's Caitlin Collins live at the White House. There's a lot happening today, Caitlin.
There certainly is, Allison and Chris. And what happened now there after initially only scheduling a briefing for two Republican lawmakers to be briefed on that confidential intelligence source in the Russia investigation? There is now going to be a bipartisan briefing today. Now, how we got to this bipartisan briefing is a very long story that continually changed overnight, even into the late evening. But what it ended with was President Trump telling aides, including Chief of Staff John Kelly, that he thought Democrats should be invited to that briefing because he didn't want them to be able to accuse the White House of playing games here and accusing them of being partisan. Now, that is because the president believes that would overshadow what he sees as the overall larger story here, that there are law enforcement officials the president believes are working against him.
The Justice Department announcing that it will hold two back-to-back meetings today about the Russia probe. The first with Republican Chairman Devin Nunes and Trey Gowdy, and the second with Gowdy and the bipartisan Gang of Eight. A spokesperson for House Speaker Paul Ryan telling CNN he won't be at the meeting due to a long-standing schedule commitment. White House Chief of Staff John Kelly, however, will be in attendance despite this statement from Press Secretary Sarah Sanders.
The president asked Chief of Staff Kelly to set up the meeting. No one from the White House staff will attend.
The decision to hold two briefings coming after sharp criticism from Democrats for being excluded from the first proposed meeting.
I've never seen anything like this. This is highly unusual that you would have such a briefing in the middle of an investigation. Highly unusual. And that it should be partisan is just totally unacceptable.
The White House initially proposing a Gang of Eight briefing next month, then moving the date up to next week before conceding to hold both meetings today. A notable change after the White House repeatedly said that Democrats didn't want to be invited.
But they aren't asking for the information. For whatever reason, it appears they don't want to see light shed on this particular investigation.
President Trump pushing back on the charge from Democrats that the briefing is politically motivated.
What I want from Rod, from the FBI, from everybody, We want transparency.
But continuing to push his unproven claim that a, quote, spy infiltrated his campaign.
All you have to do is look at the basics and you'll see. It looks like a very serious event, but we'll find out. When they look at the documents, I think people are going to see a lot of bad things happen.
Government officials telling CNN that Trump's allegation isn't true, but that hasn't stopped the president and his allies from repeating it.
If they ran a spy ring, that is an absolute red line.
I'm shocked to hear that they put a spy in the campaign. This is a deep state political hit job now spying on an opposition party campaign.
President Trump pushing the deep state conspiracy on Twitter Wednesday, a characterization his own Secretary of State has rejected.
I don't believe there's a deep state at the State Department.
The president also misquoting the former Director of National Intelligence, James Clapper, to push his narrative.
I mean, if you look at Clapper, he sort of admitted that they had spies in the campaign yesterday, inadvertently.
They were spying on a term I don't particularly like, but on what the Russians were doing, trying to understand, were the Russians infiltrating, trying to gain access, trying to gain leverage and influence?
So why doesn't he like
what they do?
So Chris and Allison, the president there are saying that James Clapper said something he simply just did not say. Now, it's important to watch the president's language overall regarding his allegations about a spy being in his campaign, because the president has a history of making outrageous statements like this with no evidence to prove them, but couching them with enough language that later on, when confronted about them, he can say it was something he merely suggested. There are a handful of examples. President Barack Obama wiretapped him, that President Barack Obama wasn't born in the United States, that a cable news host played a role in the death of an intern, that Ted Cruz's father has had something to do with JFK's assassination. They go on and on and on, just to name a few. So it's very important to watch the way that the president speaks about these allegations that there was a spy inside of his campaign.
Caitlin, thank you. Joining us now, CNN political analyst John Avlon and CNN national security analyst Samantha Vinograd. All right. So the president, we're told through AP reporting, said to a confidant, I'm using the word spy because it means something to people. And I want to use the harshest words. I want to have the
nefarious.
Most effect.
Right.
Nefarious. Although I don't know that he said that word.
Good point.
But that's part
that
of the that's part of the reporting.
Right.
And let's call this what it is from what we know of the facts. Sam, is there any known fact that supports the president's theory that he was spied on by the government?
Not by the government, but the truth is he was spied on. But it was by the Russians. We had spent so much time talking about an American spy, this fake spy that's supposedly on the campaign. When this was Spygate, we know that the spy master, Vladimir Putin, sent Russians to the United States to infiltrate the campaign. And so we're spending all this time talking about a spy and not talking about the fact that we know there are Russian spies there. We know that Mike Flynn was on the campaign. He retroactively registered as a foreign agent of Turkey. So we're looking at the wrong source of spying because the president is trying to distract us, I think.
Right. This is distract and deflect. This is classic Trump. I'm not the puppet. You're the puppet.
No puppet. You're the puppet.
Yeah, exactly. But look, I think it's also we need to give Donald Trump a lot of credit for his just he has a genius for marketing and he is a hype man. And so he seized on this phrase Spygate as a way of really capturing what he wants to accuse and hopes it gets picked up in the vernacular. And it does, not only by, you know, his advocates in the media and politics, but it becomes part of the conversation. As Sam's point is the crucial one, though. The real scandal that folks need to always remember is that Russia spied on the Trump campaign and tried to influence our elections on their behalf, as the Senate Intel Committee said, as the DHS secretary momentarily forgot. And that's the real underlying issue. This partisan hearing and the subsequent bipartisan hearing they're going to do is also a departure from investigative traditions. But everything about this is outside the norms of American politics.
But his master branding has just backfired, and we see it because he's backpedaling, okay?
Yep.
So what he is doing is saying the criminal deep state about the FBI. Then, lo and behold, yesterday, they had to have a big meeting about MS-13, where the ICE director talked about how helpful the FBI and the Department of Justice have been in cracking down on the criminal gang MS-13, President Trump was right there. So now, today, he's trying to parse, the FBI is good, that people are good in it. When I say criminal deep state, here's what I mean. Listen to this.
Well, I'd actually say, how is he going to explain to his grandchildren all of the lies, the deceit, all of the problems he's caused for this country? I think a thing that I've done for the country, the firing of James Comey, is going to go down as a very good thing. FBI is great. I know so many people in the FBI. The FBI is a fantastic institution, but some of the people at the top were rotten apples. James Comey was one of them.
No, Sam, no. You can't call it a criminal deep state and then say, just a couple of rotten apples. You can't tweet out, the FBI, quote, its reputation is in tatters, worst in history. No, you don't get to today be like, I just met two people.
But what else is new? He does this with the Department of Justice. He does this with the intelligence community. He does this with the State Department. He likes people in these departments and agencies when it serves his political or personal interests. And we've seen this across the board on every issue. And the fact of the matter is, you can't pick and choose when you like the people that are serving your country. There has to be consistency on every issue, whether it's Russia, mm-hmm. he disregards the intelligence community. But then when they're serving a political purposes or making one of his policies look good, all of a sudden they're best friends. It doesn't work like that. Mm.
So you have the echo effect on one side, which is basically, you know, Fox News, state TV, saying spy, 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 spies, building up what he's saying, mm-hmm. okay? Now on the other side, you have what's supposed to be this earnest attempt at oversight and fact, okay? So we were going to have a meeting today where only Republicans mm-hmm. went and got briefed on this. As of 9 to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time last night when we were with Leader Pelosi, she did not know that they would be involved in this. She went on to say, you know, in the town hall last night, how wrong this is. She's never heard of this before. Only now are we told that there will be two briefings, Gang of Eight and that. How big are the implications of this meeting today?
Well, I think they're significant solely because the first meeting with Devin Nunes, the concern there is that's going to be held behind closed doors and Trey Gowdy, and that could be funneled to the Trump administration, given Nunes's pattern of back-channeling the White House. The bipartisan Gang of Eight meeting later in the day, will that be for show? Will it be the exact same information? I mean, bifurcating them itself causes questions, serious ones.
But what do you think, Sam, about the idea that there has to be two meetings for whatever reason, and the idea that just the DOJ and the FBI are opening up their sources and methods to, at the behest of Devin Nunes, reveal who their informant is?
I think that this is awful, and the truth is that we have laws that govern when you release information to Congress on intelligence issues for a reason. We have the Intelligence Authorization Act of 1991 that specifically speaks about the fact that departments and agencies should keep certain members of Congress, and I'm stressing the certain, fully and currently informed on intelligence issues. That's not what this is. The Gang of Eight is being retroactively briefed on information after Donald Trump's friends and family. And this undermines the historically nonpartisan nature of the intelligence community. So what precedent are we sending? We are literally politicizing intelligence and inserting bias into a process which is an awful precedent.
That's the key point, is that this isn't not only a departure from our best traditions, but it's the politicization of intelligence and justice, which is something that has been seen as sacred. And the friends and family plan that Sam just indicated is just an indication of how much of a departure.
And Allison called it out earlier that he is backpedaling. He says mm-hmm. this is about transparency. The president who won't release his taxes says all that matters is transparency. Who's going to believe that? Anyway. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Thank you.
Breaking news. Journalists are witnessing the dismantling of one of North Korea's nuclear test sites, we think. CNN's Will Ripley is one of a select number of reporters who saw it happen. He joins us live on the phone from North Korea. Will, you got us?
Hey, Chris. Yeah, I'm here. I'm actually on a train heading back to Wonsan, where we spoke a couple of days ago. We left the North Korean test site about 2 hours ago. The train pulled out less than an hour ago. We spent 9 hours on the ground at Punggye-ri. It's the first time that international press has ever been allowed to site. And what we saw was what North Korea claims is the destruction of this test site. So they let us go up to three different tunnels. They opened the door. One of the tunnels was used to conduct five of North Korea's six nuclear tests, the most recent last year that triggered a 6.3 magnitude earthquake back in September. They were very dark. We weren't allowed to go inside the tunnels, but we saw essentially explosives as far as we could see down in the, into the tunnels. And they closed the door, brought us up to this observation post, and they blow the tunnel up. And then we'd go to the next tunnel and see it. And then they would blow that one up. They also blew up probably 9 or 10 buildings on the site as well, buildings that were used to house the researchers and house all of the equipment to measure the magnitude of the nuclear test. So it was, you know, at least on the surface, it seems that the North Koreans were following through on this promise. But, you know, there are only journalists in our group. There were no experts who were there to verify exactly what was happening. So we don't know how far into the tunnels the explosions actually happened. We don't know if they just closed off the entrance, which could easily be bulldozed open again, or if, in fact, the tunnels are indeed, you know, completely destroyed, as the North Koreans claim. And when we tried to ask them about how we'd be able to verify it, their only answer to us was, you've seen it with your own eyes. We're being transparent. We're taking steps towards denuclearization. So clearly they're trying to send a message to President Trump ahead of this planned summit in Singapore on June 12th. They want him to believe that they are following through on their promise to get rid of their nuclear weapons. But, you know, all we can say is what we saw. And we saw a lot of explosions, and we weren't able to interview any officials in depth about what was actually happening. But the North Koreans say that the Punggye-ri is now shut down for good. So is that really the case? We can only show you the pictures, and I'll tell you what, when we get back to Wonsan and can actually feed this video, it is really extraordinary stuff just to see this place that we've heard about for so many years and never been allowed to see until now.
Will, what an assignment. I mean, just it's so incredible to have you there as one of the journalists on the ground and to give us all of the context about whether or not you can believe your own eyes. So we'll look forward to seeing that video when you get back. Thank you.
And a key insight from him, there were no experts, only journalists. So do they know what they're seeing? Do they know the significance of it? It's a little bit of a gray area.
All right. Meanwhile, with North Korea now threatening a nuclear showdown with the U.S., is this summit with President Trump still going to happen? Senator Angus King weighs in.
This appetite for destruction and division and only a passing familiarity with how the Constitution works. And our Article I branch of government, the Congress, that's me, is utterly supine in the face of the moral vandalism that flows from the White House daily. I do not think that the founders could have anticipated that the beauty of their invention might someday founder on the rocks of reality television, and that Congress would be such willing accomplices to this calamity.
Now, Senator Flake prefaced this by saying, here's the good news. I'm not kidding. Check the transcript. He said, here's the good news, and then said all of that.
Let's bring in John Avalon, who slipped Jeff Flake the truth serum for him, his own truth.
Oh.
He is now able to speak because he's leaving the Senate.
But look, first of all, senators should speak their own truth even before they know they're not up for re-election. But what's extraordinary about this speech is that you've got a sitting senator of the same party in a blistering critique of a sitting president that's not like anything in the same moral universe of critiques of previous presidents. This is really strong, almost dystopian language about our commander-in-chief. It's a warning, and maybe that Jeff Flake is setting himself up to a primary challenge to the president. That's been rumored. But he has certainly been strong and really principled and blistering in his critique in a way that exceeds even John McCain and Bob Corker.
Flake ended that riff by saying, so where is the good news? It's that I think we've hit bottom. Do you believe that?
Look, we all know you need to hit bottom before you can admit you have a problem to get better. I do believe that there is a civic silver lining to the stress test we're enduring as a nation, and that's what Jeff Flake is pointing to. Democracy cannot be a spectator sport. It's all about we the people, and people who've sort of said it's someone else's problem, you end up enabling extreme voices taking over the political process, and that's what we're seeing. So if it does lead to more people taking civic responsibility and straightening their civic backbone, that's a good thing. The one contradiction is that Jeff Flake is leaving the Senate.
Right.
In the face of a tough primary and opposition from his president.
And he's bad-mouthing a president of his own party when a lot of the people within his own party says, wait, what do you mean this is a bad time?
But
cut regulations, economy is good, got out of the Iran deal, got rid of the ACA mandate. We're doing great.
There's a lot of great things in the economy. And President Trump deserves credit for some things, and credit where credit is due. But what you just described is a chapter from Profiles in Courage. It's when you stand up to your constituency based on what you believe in.
All right, John Avalon, thank you very much for your insights into all of that. Joining us now to discuss all of this is independent Senator Angus King of Maine. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning.
What's up with these two meetings today? Why do we need two meetings to meet with the FBI and the DOJ about this informant?
Well, I'll answer that question in a minute, but I can't resist commenting on John Avlon's final observation, and that is every member of the Senate in Profiles in Courage lost the next election. It was the end of their career. So, you know, it's a great, it's one of the greatest books, I think, about politics. I just reread it about 6 months ago.
I mean, and what does that tell us?
Well, it tells you that political courage can come at a cost. That's the reality. But all of those people changed history, and they're remembered when a lot of their colleagues that didn't exhibit that kind of courage have long been lost to history.
Okay.
Let me get to your
question.
That's
a good silver lining. Yes, go ahead.
Why are there two meetings? I don't know. I think the reason there probably were two meetings is that they scheduled one with Devin Nunes and Trey Gowdy, Republican members of the House. There was such an outcry from just the general public and also from Democrats here in the Senate and House that they said, well, we better have another meeting. First, yesterday, the other meeting was going to be a week from now, and now I understand this morning the other meeting is going to be a couple of hours later.
Yeah.
There really ought to only be one meeting,
but are
so
you
everybody sees the same data, the same information.
Well, that's the point. Are you going to learn different things? Are different things going to be shared at these two different meetings?
Well, I suspect that Rod Rosenstein and Director Ray will say the same things in the two different meetings, but we've all had the experience of you hear sometimes what you want to hear in a meeting. That's why I think it's always better to have a larger group so that everybody walks out with the same understanding.
Yeah.
But that's the way it's going to happen. But at least they are having the second meeting. You'll have a broader group of people there to understand it. But the other question is, what's this meeting all about? Is it about general issues of the Russia investigation, or is it about this narrow issue of the FBI, frankly, doing its job, which is to follow up on reasonable allegations of espionage of people from a foreign power trying to infiltrate a presidential campaign? That's what the FBI is supposed to do. It would be malpractice if they didn't follow up and try to explore what was going on, whosever campaign those people were working for.
Well, I mean, you raised the perfect point. And so the fact that the president is trying to call this standard operating procedure a spy scandal, do you think, from talking to your constituents, that it's having an effect? I mean, do you think that the people of the FBI, the men and women who try to fight crime, I mean, I've been talking about how there was that split screen yesterday of talking about the FBI in glowing terms when they're fighting MS-13 and then calling them the criminal deep state when they're doing their job trying to figure out if there was any Russians that tried to collude with the campaign. Do you think that that's having an effect on their crime-fighting role?
Unfortunately, I think it is. I think people are hearing that. It's being repeated. They hear deep state, they hear conspiracy, they hear criminal deep state, criminal conspiracy, Spygate, all of those things. And I think people are, the fact that the president has never yet acknowledged what the Russians did in the 2016 election. He's never said, yeah, this was an attack on our democracy, which should be firmly repulsed, and we should be preventing its future occurrence. He's never said that, and that means I've got constituents in Maine and people across the country who are saying, yeah, this is all, the whole thing is a hoax, it's a witch hunt, there's nothing to it. The fact is, it was one of the most serious attacks on our country. It was sophisticated, it came right from Putin, there's no question what they were trying to do, and there's no question that they're going to be back and do it again. And as long as the president keeps denying that, it does have an effect. I don't know what, I can't put a number on it. I'd say 20 to 30% of the people think the whole thing is a big waste of time, when in reality, it's a grave issue that needs to be dealt with. Otherwise, they're going to keep doing it.
Yeah, one last question about this meeting today. Are you happy that the FBI and the DOJ are revealing the identity of their confidential informant?
No, I think that's a mistake. I think it's unfortunate because it could have a chilling effect on people willing to work with the agencies on a confidential basis. Again, we're not talking about evidence in a court here. If there's a court action, if there's some criminal action, witnesses do have to come forward. But this was simply trying to gather information, not on a criminal matter, but on a counterespionage matter, on a determination whether a presidential campaign had been infiltrated by people that were working cooperatively with a foreign adversary. And again, as I said at the beginning, that's exactly what the FBI is supposed to investigate. They were trying to protect Donald Trump's campaign. They weren't trying to infiltrate it and steal his debate notes or something, which he implies that a spy was in his campaign. They were trying to find out whether somebody was trying to infiltrate his campaign and convey information or gain information from the Russians. Mm-hmm. If I had somebody in my campaign doing that, I'd want to know it. I wouldn't want to. I'd want the FBI to find out about it so we could put a stop to it. He keeps bringing it back to somehow they were. He used the term this was political spying, as if they were doing this to get information on him. In reality, they were doing it in a very quiet, confidential way to not cast aspersions on his campaign in the midst of the election.
Senator, before I let you go, do you know that it's my co-host's last day on New Day today?
I heard a rumor to that effect, and I wore one of my best lobster ties just for that occasion.
I don't know that you have any other tie.
You know? Oh, I have a few. I have a few, but we're going to miss Chris. Chris, your questions were always good, straightforward, and you followed the facts. That's what you're supposed to do. So we'll miss you in the morning, but you're going to have to readjust your whole clock, man, staying up till 9 or 10 at night. I'm sure that's a whole new world for you.
I'm up anyway. I'm completely crazy. I work all the time. But let me return the favor. In Profiles in Courage, which I recently reread also, is Angus doing the I can't hear you thing that he does when he thinks he's going to get
hit? I think he's just leaving.
Are you trying that trick again?
I think he's just taking out his earpiece and leaving.
Senator, can you hear us?
Well, we're going to miss Chris for sure, and I'll miss your questions. It always cleared my sinuses early in the morning when you'd come after me.
I think he's you. All right. Thanks. Senator, can you hear us?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyway, in Profiles in Courage, I don't believe that, by the way. I think he does it as a device. The Profiles in Courage, Kennedy in the forward to it, the intro, quotes Hemingway and says that courage, Profiles in Courage, is defined as grace under pressure. Senator King, even though that was a cheap trick that he just did there, is one of our few that we have there right now who, no matter what's coming his way, he shows grace under pressure. So I return the favor. He's been great for the show.
We always appreciate him coming on, even despite the technical audio gremlins that we often have.
That's what I do when they tell me to rap. What? What'd they say?
Sorry, lost you.
Go longer?
Lost you.
All right. Republican Senator Ron Johnson wants to talk to more than 30 current and former FBI and Justice Department officials about the Russia investigation. What does he want to know? Does he believe in the deep state? The senator makes the case to you next.
And 1968 was one of the most consequential years in U.S. history. Don't miss this special two-night CNN original series.
Mike Pompeo was taking questions about the deep state during his testimony before Congress. Please listen to what
he
said.
Do you believe there is a criminal deep state at the State Department?
I haven't seen the comments from the president. I don't believe there's a deep state at the State Department.
Okay. Thank you. You formerly served as CIA director. Do you believe your colleagues at the CIA are part of the criminal deep state?
You know, this term deep state's been thrown around. I say this, the employees that worked for me at the CIA nearly uniformly were aimed at achieving the president's objectives and America's objectives.
Joining us now, Republican Senator Ron Johnson. Senator, thank you for making the time. Appreciate it.
Good morning, Chris. So you wanted me on one last time in the morning to duke it out, huh?
No, I want you on many more times. The offer stands. Transferring the offer from morning to night, you're always welcome to come on and make the case to the American people.
The good news, that time slot is before my bedtime, so we'll try and make that happen, too.
Good. Thank you, Senator. Let's start at what should be a point of agreement. No question that there are legitimate questions to be asked about how the Clinton probe was handled, how the Trump probe was handled, and I get you want to ask those questions, but the president's idea that it is rotten to the core, that it is a deep state, do you believe that, or do you believe Mike Pompeo, the man who has reason to know the truth?
Well, as you said, there are a number of questions, and there's certainly potentially some bad actors. There's some, as I said before, possible corruption at some of the highest levels. After I said that, we got the Office of Inspector General report on Andrew McCabe that pretty conclusively proved that he lied repeatedly under oath to his own FBI investigators. So, you know, that's why it's so important, Chris, to get all this information out in the open. We have to restore the credibility of the FBI and Department of Justice in the eyes of the American public, and right now that's under question.
Well, but largely it's under question because the president of the United States keeps saying that they are all rotten. Now, he's pulled back on that position, but that's why I want to start with our operating premise. Do you believe in the Department of Justice, the FBI, the CIA? Do you believe in them as institutions?
Oh, the vast majority of people working in those agencies are patriots. They're trying to keep our nation safe. They're risking their lives to do so. And I truly believe that's what the president believes as well. But again, there are some serious questions. And Chris, I have a different perspective on all of this. I was actually in the briefing in September of 2016. We were briefed by Lisa Monaco, Director Comey, and Secretary Johnson. And they briefed the Big 12 at that point in time. And they were telling us that they had evidence of Russian interference. They tried to hack into voter files. The entire tone, what they were requesting in that meeting is they had it under control, they were dealing with the states, and they wanted us to go out and communicate that this was going to be a legitimate election because they had it under control. That was exactly what they were trying to do a couple months before the election. But then, basically on that, from their perspective, the wrong person got elected, and all of a sudden this is the greatest threat to our democracy that has ever occurred. So there is a fair amount of hypocrisy that's occurred during this timeline, which is, again, why I would say it's so important to have the public understand exactly what happened. It has been like pulling teeth under the Obama administration and even currently to get the information to Congress. We are the body that investigates and reveals us to the public. That public exposure is the only way we're going to restore credibility. My whole problem with the special counsel, once you have a criminal investigation, that information gets locked up and this thing drags on. It's been over a year now, and we still have all these questions and more credibility is being questioned. So, again, that is the problem. That's why we need this all exposed.
Right, but you can't blame the institutions for the negativity that you guys are putting on it. The reason that their credibility is in question is because they're continuously assumptions made about them being in bad faith. You said the president believes it's just a few bad apples. Senator, doesn't say that. He consistently damns the entire institution.
First of all, don't put words in my mouth. I said I believe the president believes that the vast majority of people work in the FBI.
I know, but I'm asking you why you think that when he says the opposite all the time. Why are you giving him the benefit of the doubt when he says the opposite?
Because I believe that's exactly true. When Secretary Kelly, for example, restored the morale of CBP and ICE, coming in here and I listened to General Kelly talk to those folks, and the president has that exact same type of attitude. But again, what we need to do is we need to find out who the bad actors were, exactly what happened. We need to get that out in the public as quickly as possible to bring this to a close.
Right.
Because we have serious issues: North Korea, Iran, Syria, Russia. We have some real problems in this world.
So you want these questions investigated. You do not think they should be the subject matter of a special counsel, though, correct?
I just think the special counsel was appointed too soon because once you have that criminal investigation, it is very difficult for example, people to come forward. I was really expecting all kinds of informants coming forward. That's what we heard. If James Comey was going to exonerate Hillary Clinton, we thought there was going to be basically a mini rebellion within the FBI. But because there's a criminal investigation, because people want to protect their jobs, we haven't had that. We're getting some indications now there's some FBI agents that want to come forward. Please come to my committee. I want to know because I want to restore the credibility of the FBI and the Department of Justice. That is the goal of my investigation.
Why would FBI agents come forward when the president of the United States is looking to smear as many of them as possible?
Hopefully to tell the truth so the public can understand exactly what happened and we can get this entire sordid episode behind us.
But why would they have confidence in the process when we're looking at today? You were going to have just your side go in and talk to intelligence officials and get a reckoning of whether or not there was a spy in the campaign when they've already said
Chris,
there
I,
wasn't
I,
and all say, of the I, institutions I was, are run by said, Republicans.
You said I have nothing to do with that. But trust me, whistleblowers can come to our committee. We've protected all kinds of whistleblowers coming forward. I am the Senate Oversight Committee. We rely on whistleblowers to get this information out to the public. So please come forward. We will protect you.
Do you think it was wrong for them to try to do this in a one-sided way?
No, listen, I'm glad it's being done in a bipartisan way. I was part of the Gang of 12 that met with President Obama's team in September 2016. That's the way this should occur.
Let me ask you about something else. You have a bill that you believe the president is going to sign into law. It's called the Right to Try legislation. Now, this is very important and has been controversial. It gives terminally ill patients a way to access drugs that are still experimental. A lot of them are often called orphan drugs, where there isn't enough need for them for the companies to want to put them out in a big way. There's not enough profit motive, really. What will this bill do to help those types of people in extremis?
Well, first of all, they have to be drugs that have already passed phase one, the safety approval of the FDA, and still they're in the approval process, which means the companies think they have enough potential that they're going to spend millions trying to get final approval. But no, Chris, that was a big win for terminally ill patients and their families. It has restored a little bit of freedom, a little bit of hope. So now it's those patients and their doctors that can have, that can make that decision to try something when they have no other options. They don't qualify for clinical trials. They've exhausted all other forms of treatment. They are desperate. And we're just returning a little bit of freedom and hope. And by the way, this is a big win for President Trump, too. Had it not been for his public support and private support, I don't think this would have ever passed the House. So, again, this is a big win primarily for those patients that have advocated for it. And listen, I was in the gallery with unfortunately, victims of ALS, Duchenne muscular dystrophy. It was tears and hugs all around when that bill passed the House on Tuesday.
Good for you. Good for all of you down there from finding a way to seek some common ground and act on it and help the American people. Good for you, Senator, and thanks for being on the show as always.
Good luck. Look forward to joining you in the evening.
We'll be there. We'll be getting after it, and I will be calling you frequently. Let's put it that way. Take care,
okay.
Senator.
Allison. Take care.
All right, President Trump has a new target for tariffs, cars. How could it affect your family? CNN Money is next. Automobiles and parts. Chief business correspondent Christine Romans is in our Money Center with more. What does this mean, Christine?
You know, the Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross, Allison, claims car imports have eroded our domestic auto industry. He plans to investigate if that hurts national security. Now, a similar probe led to steel and aluminum tariffs earlier this year. This follows Trump's promise to U.S. auto workers. He said this: after many decades of losing your jobs to other countries, you have waited long enough, calling the auto industry critical to U.S. strength. The investigation will cover auto parts, as well as cars, SUVs, vans, light trucks. Any tariffs would hit Asian automakers the hardest. About a third of all U.S. car imports are from Asia. And the announcement sparking a big sell-off overnight for the likes of Toyota, Honda, Hyundai. The biggest loser, Mazda, down more than 5%. Mazda does not produce cars in the U.S., but many foreign automakers do have plants here. However, they also export parts and cars to the U.S. from, you know, Asia, Mexico, and Canada. Auto tariffs would be the next front for the White House's trade battles, including those ongoing talks with China. This also puts new pressure on Canada and Mexico, you guys. NAFTA talks have stalled. Guess what? Mainly due to auto provisions, Chris.
Christine Romans, appreciate the insight as always. So here's a tease for you, an NBA player to report.
This is the first of three big sports stories today, right? LeBron, he's not old. He's only 33, but last night he looked worn out at times. And when you're playing against a team with three of the starters under 24, I mean, it's bound to wear on you. This Bleacher Report brought to you by Ford, going further so you can. No one has been able to stop the Celtics on their home court in these playoffs. That includes a tired LeBron. Rookie Jason Tatum led the way last night with 24 points. They are now just one win away from a trip to the finals and to the NHL. Game 7 of the Eastern Conference Final. Capitals and Tampa Bay Lightning. Washington has the biggest star in the sport in Alex Ovechkin, but until this year, he had never made it past the second round. He came out on a mission, scoring just over a minute into the game. Washington wins 4-0, advancing to the final for the first time since 1998. And NFL owners announcing a new national anthem policy meant to end player protests on the field. Under the new policy, all team personnel, including players, must stand for the anthem on the field, though players do have the option to remain in the locker room if they choose not to stand. Anyone who does not stand during the anthem while on the field will be fined by the league. And I'm told the Players Association did find out, guys, about this news on a newswire. So you can imagine that just adds to their fury not being consulted.
Right. I mean, they're not happy with it. And who knows what they'll do next, what their next move is. I mean, it sounds sort of...
They investigate certain... and figure out what they can do, right?
Well, we've had one team come forward, the Jets.
Yes.
They're the brother of the owner, Woody Johnson's the owner. He's actually the ambassador to Britain right now in the Trump administration. His brother said, we'll cover the fines. And it'll be interesting to see if all the other teams follow suit.
Yeah, that's an interesting comment by him, too. Mm.
You know. Thank you.
You got it.
Okay, new body cam video just released shows police in Milwaukee handcuffing and tasing an NBA player over a parking dispute. The police chief says the department disciplined the officers involved, but the player says he is taking legal action. CNN's Ryan Young is live in Milwaukee with more. Ryan, what have you learned?
Good morning, Allison. Look, the reaction to this video has been pretty swift. It was even trending on Twitter last night. The big question now is, why did a simple parking violation lead to a tasing and arrest?
Milwaukee's police department is apologizing over this incident from January.
Taser, taser, taser!
Which ended in Milwaukee Bucks player Sterling Brown being tased. You can see via the newly released body cam video, Brown's car double parked across two handicapped spaces.
Can't get another squad here.
Around 8 minutes into the video, one of the officers yells for Brown to get his hands out of his pockets.
Take your hands out of your pockets now.
Oh, I got stuff in my hands.
Four officers then grab Brown and wrestle him to the ground.
The ground.
And tase him.
Taser, taser, taser.
You can hear Brown grunting. The encounter resulted in Brown's arrest, but the basketball player was never charged. Milwaukee Mayor Tom Barrett calls the video disturbing.
No citizen should be treated this way. The actions I saw also demand accountability.
In a statement, the police chief said, "I am sorry this incident escalated to this level," and notes that unnamed officers were recently disciplined after an internal investigation. The footage comes just a day after Brown's lawyer announced that the rookie would be filing a civil rights lawsuit against the city's police force. In a statement posted to his Twitter account, Brown says the incident, which he believes should have ended with a simple parking ticket, shows racism towards the minority community, the abuse of power, and the lack of accountability for officers involved. The Bucks also released a statement saying in part, "The abuse and intimidation that Sterling experienced at the hands of Milwaukee police was